Well, good evening, family. It is another time for a window to look through. And this is the second week of our installment in our eight-week series of talking about the parables of Jesus. Tonight, as a Bible class, we're going to come and we're going to study Luke chapter 15, verses 8 through 10. That's right, two verses. And this is a powerful series that we've been walking through. Again, I hope you're engaging as we meet on Wednesdays and on Sunday mornings to talk through these parables of the Christ. So bow with me for a word of prayer and grab your copy of the scriptures. Father God, I want to thank you so much for my family and thank you for this privilege to join with them in the word of God as we study about the parables of the Christ. Lord, I pray that you would illuminate our hearts and our minds as we watch from all over the country today. Lord, feed us the bread of heaven and the bread of life, Lord, so that we may be equipped for the work of the ministry. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you, Father. Amen. Grab your copy of the scriptures, family. Luke chapter 15, verses 8 through 10. That's right. Very powerful text for us on tonight. And so the title of our message tonight is going to be The Parable of the Lost Coin. Last week in this series, we talked about the parable of the lost sheep. So let me share with you now the parable of the lost coin. The Bible says, "What woman of you having 10 silver coins, if she loses one, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it. And when she has found it, she calls her friends and neighbors together, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the piece which I lost.' And likewise I say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Amen. Wow. Let's get at it. Now, family, when we come to this portion of the text, Jesus is in the first year of his ministry, and it's commonly called the year of popularity. Now, Jesus' name now is like a household word. He's known everywhere in the region of Galilee by all people. He's been preaching and teaching all over this space, and people are flocking from all around to hear him proclaim God's word. Now, when Jesus preached, never a man has spoke like this. On last week, we talked about what happened when he came to Levi's party and how all the tax collectors and the sinners came to hear him. Jesus was interacting with the outcasts of society, the despised, the rejected, the unlovable. And also, in addition to that, the religious crowd was there. And Jesus is telling these stories in this party because he wants the religious people to know what the heart of God is like in the earth and what God is actively doing in the earth. Because they were questioning, if this was the Messiah, why would he be hanging out with sinners and tax collectors in places like these? So Jesus began to tell them stories. The first story he told was the parable of the lost sheep. Go back last week and look at that on our Facebook page. Then tonight, he tells the second story at the same party. And it's about the woman who loses a coin. So let's unpack this lesson tonight and let's see exactly what God wants us to know. Our first point, the woman's property. In verse 8, the Bible says, "What woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it?" It's a question, right? Now, when you come to this portion of the story, Jesus says there's a sister who has some money. She's got 10 silver coins. Now, this money in that day was quite a savings for somebody to possess. The silver coin that was in her possession is called a drachma. Now, this drachma was special. See, it was a special Jewish currency that was very valuable to whomever had it in their possession. For example, one coin was said to be worth 4 days of labor. That's right. Now, in that culture and in that day, this sister would have been considered as somebody who had substantial financial means. That's right. She was okay when it came to her resources because she had a little wealth on her side. Secondly, we learn from this passage that the drachma was also a special coin. And it was a special coin because it had great sentimental value. Let me explain. It was said that in that tradition and culture, that the drachma was pretty and it was silver. And it was often used by brides on their wedding days to adorn their wedding veils. They would attach them to the end of their veils as they walked down the aisle or participated in the wedding ceremony. The drachma was said to then have brought value to the bride's presence and to the sacred ceremony. These coins were said to have been sentimental because they were passed down from a bride's family to her on her special day. It was a sacred coin and it was a sentimental coin. And not only that, it was said to have had the inscription of God upon it. You know, like in our day, our money has "In God We Trust." There was some inscription from the sacredness of God on this coin. So it was value for all three of these reasons. Sentimental reasons, sacred reasons, yes. And then most of all, for the beauty that went into the bride's wedding day. Now here's the application. When I think about a special coin like this, you know what I see? I see a picture of humanity. Human beings are just like drachmas in the eyes of God. That's right. Humanity is God's property and very expensive to Him. Do you know you and I have been made in the image and likeness of God? He made us and then He placed His inscription on us, family. So we're made much different than any other creatures on the earth. We're different than the fish, than the reptiles, than the birds, and the insects. And this is because we are more valuable than they are as the things God has created. So we also have something that is called sentimental value to God, sacredness to God. And the Bible teaches that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him will not perish, beloved, but have everlasting life. Can I get a witness right there? The next thing we see in this verse is that not only is the coin sacred and sentimental and special to God or to the woman in the house, but the coin was precious to the woman. The Bible says that she has this valuable in her possession. And some kind of way, it got out of her grasp. It was no longer in her sight. And so she lost something very, very precious to her in a specific location. She lost it in the house. Now, New Beginnings, if you've been with me anytime in these 14 or 15 years almost we've been together, you probably heard me preach this message. So let me spend a little bit more time in unpacking it for you as we talk about the specificity of the house, right? So the house that the woman occupied was called, was a Middle Eastern home. The home was probably small and without modern fixtures. It didn't have lights and carpet and electricity and plumbing like you and I know of today in our places. No, this woman most likely had some rough stone dirt floors with crevices perhaps in the cracks of the floor. Now, in addition to this, houses back then were very dark, and so they were known for not having great light to come in, and they would have to input windows in the clay doors or clay walls to put candles inside so that light could try to get in. So losing something like this coin in the house meant that she lost something that she probably couldn't find. It would almost be equivalent to like looking for a needle in a haystack. In other words, this was going to be virtually impossible to complete this assignment. So I see another comparison here in the story family. Man, just like this coin, has also gotten separated from God. And just like the coin, we're lost in the house. Yep. You know, man got separated from God because of sin. Man had gotten away from God because of what Adam and Eve did in the garden. And man, just like the coin, has fallen in the dirt of the earth. The earth is the Lord's footstool. You do know that, right? And we were lost in the earth, unable to get back to God because of sin. Now, you ask again, how did this happen, Pastor? Well, you remember the story in Genesis chapter 3, when God told Adam and Eve not to eat of the particular tree in the Garden of Eden, and they ate it. And he warned them that you do this, the day you do this, you shall surely die. Well, their eyes came open and they died spiritually and went and hid themselves from the presence of God. And this plague called sin separated us from God. It was passed down from our parents, Adam and Eve, to us, making everyone who was ever created in the image of God a sinner, separated from him because of rebellion. The Bible teaches that man is lost in the earth. And just like the coin family, something had to be done to find man and restore him back into a right relationship with his owner, his creator. We've looked at the woman's property and what happened when she lost it. So let's look now at the woman's plan and what she'll do to recover what she's lost. The Bible says in verse 8b, does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully till she finds it? Notice this, class. When we come to this portion of the story, we see Jesus reveal the woman's plan to locate and search for the thing she's lost. Jesus actually reveals to us her plan. He says, she lights a lamp to locate the fallen coin. Then she swept the house carefully to find the lost coin. Her method was to sweep and to search. Sweep and to search. Sweep and to search. And she searched in the dark areas of the house. And then the text says, she lights a lamp to locate the fallen coin. Now, this lamp that he's talking about would have been a small light or a candle almost that would be set ablaze in the house so that the woman could see. Powerful picture. See, this woman sets a fire in her home, attaches it on a portable illuminator, candle, and sets it up high in the darkness so that it will illuminate the house. And then she sweeps the dirt to find the coin. Can I say it this way? She swept and searched until she could get a glimmer of the beautiful coin that was lost in the dirt. She swept with an eye to find that which was lost. She swept and searched with a focus for the one thing that she cherished that got out of her position. She swept and searched in specific places to discover what had gotten lost, beloved. Here's the application. When I look at this parable, I see why he's telling the story to the Pharisees who were there that night at the party with the tax collectors and sinners. Because I see a similar activity happening in the earth today. It's what heaven is doing in the earth. Just like this woman, God has a plan to find his lost valuables. You see, God has lit a lamp in the earth to locate Well, fallen man is covered by the dirt of this world. God's light is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this light shines so that God can draw all men back unto himself. And without this light, it's impossible for man to see God. Man lives in the darkness, and the darkness cannot comprehend God. Man needs light to understand who God is. God searches for him, even when man doesn't want to be found. Can I get a witness right there? God, right this hour, beloved, is sweeping the earth, searching for man this hour. God is sweeping in the drug house, the White House, the poor house, the rich house, the ghettos, the crack house, the suburbs, the schoolhouses. He's sweeping and searching with great urgency. And the light of God can be seen from highways, in classrooms, textbooks, magazines, airlines, online, on land, sporting events. God's light is lighting up the world. It's the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. And guess what, family? This evening, you may know of someone who's lost in the darkness of this world. You may know of someone who's lost in the house, covered with the dirt of sin, the sin of alcoholism, substance abuse, unbelief, immoral activity, stealing, racism, pride, hatred, fornication, adultery, greed, rebellion, homosexuality, idolatry, and a whole host of other stuff. It's okay. They're covered in the darkness of this world, and God has lit a light. Why? He's sweeping the earth, trying to find them and to get their attention, to bring them back into a right relationship with him. Here it is. Mankind was never meant to be out of his presence. Mankind was never meant to be separated from him. Mankind was never meant to be lost in the dirt of this world. You belong in his possession, and the master of the house is sweeping and searching for you today. Can I turn the light on in this passage? The Bible says that after she lit the candle and swept the house, that she found the lost coin. Well, we've looked at the woman's property. We've looked at the woman's plan. Let me show you now the woman's proclamation. The Bible says in verse 9 that when she finds it, she calls all her friends and neighbors together and she says, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that was lost." Beloved, when we come to this final portion of the parable, Jesus says, when she finds the coin, she issues a personal, private, and public proclamation. She called her friends and her neighbors to a celebration, and the celebration was given because she found what was valuable to her. She wanted everyone to know that she had made contact with the lost coin. She celebrated being restored to her most prized and lost valuable. She called her friends and her neighbors to have them rejoice with her. And I noticed a specific element of her celebration. The importance of her celebration is not how it got lost or why it was covered in the dirt, but rather that it was found. That's where the emphasis is in the text. See, the woman had joy because it was found and it was no longer lost. There is joy with the woman because she saved that which was lost. There was joy with her because she saved what was secure, sentimental, and sacred to her. There's joy in her home, beloved, and she wants others to experience that same joy. She called him, "Girl, guess what I've done? I've found my lost coin." Can't you see the picture now? And the picture here is being told because in the same way, yes, Jesus does the same thing every time somebody is lost. Look at verse 10. It's in the passage. He says, in the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Jesus is saying, there is kara, is the Greek word here, and it's the word for rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God. Listen, to be more exact in this text, it is rejoicing that arises from the unseen realm of life. Yeah, it's rejoicing that's happening right now. It's in the present tense, this word. See, this rejoicing takes place in the presence of the angels of God. This rejoicing will continue to take place as sinners continue to come back to God. This rejoicing is also eternal. For when we get to heaven, we will kara, because we have been found and restored back into a right relationship with Jesus. The angels in this text are with God in the celebration. They live with him in heaven, serve him in two worlds, in heaven and on earth. And they have been with God for a very long time and have learned to obey and to worship him and to rejoice over what they see him doing in the earth. Well, the Bible says they rejoice when they see him sweeping the earth. They rejoice when they see him light a fire in the universe to locate his lost drachmas. They rejoice when God is on the move to rescue people dying in sin in a fallen world. And in addition to them knowing and worshiping God, they also rejoice over the sinner who repents. Secondly, we learn in this last verse, and I'm almost through, that because they are eternal beings, their rejoicing is manifested in three ways. Can I give it to you right now? Listen, their joy is manifested through present rejoicing, future rejoicing, and eternal rejoicing. Isn't that powerful? In other words, they can't help but rejoice for us. They see how unworthy we are of salvation, and they see how gracious God is for saving us. Jesus says that there is rejoicing right now over the one sinner who repents in the presence of the angels of God. Beloved, that is just good Bible. Now listen, the angels in heaven are the ones who rejoice when one sinner repents and makes a decision to serve Jesus Christ. Now, repentance means to turn away from sin, to be sorry for all you've done, to change your ways and your actions and change of heart. That's what this means. Heaven will rejoice when the gangbanger repents. So they'll rejoice over you. Heaven will rejoice when the drug dealer repents, so they'll rejoice over you. Heaven will rejoice when the liar repents. Heaven will rejoice when the thief repents, when the adulterer repents, when the prideful repents, when the immoral repents, when the racist repents, any sinner repents. Heaven rejoices, and heaven is waiting to rejoice over somebody you know today. But first, they must see the gospel, hear the gospel, believe the gospel, repent and believe the gospel. Why repent? Because the Bible says repentance is necessary unto salvation. It's much more than believing. It's turning away from the behavior and the activity that separated you from God. Well, I got to leave you now, but I want to leave you with some great news. It was because of our sins that on that great Good Friday on a hill called Calvary, outside of the city of Jerusalem, that Jesus died upon an old rugged cross. He died that you and I might be saved. He died to take your place and my place, to pay for all of our sins. He was crucified with nails in his hands, a crown of thorns on his head, a spear in his side. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. And while he was in the grave, the scripture says he took the sting out of death and got victory over the grave. And early Sunday morning, God the Father raised him back to life so that you and I could also have victory over the grave. And now he sits at the right-hand throne of God, making intercession for you and I. He's praying for us. Jesus is alive. And if you know someone who's lost in the house, or you're lost in the house, you can be saved today. If you're lost in the house, you can be found today. If you're lost in the house, you can have eternal life today. You can have heaven rejoice over you too. If you say yes to Jesus, yes to his salvation, and yes to eternal life through Christ. Let me pray for you now, family. Our Father and our God, thank you so much for this incredible message tonight and this reminder of just how much you love us and how much you care. Lord, we are grateful, eternally grateful, for this great gospel. Thank you for the ministry of parables and teaching so very plainly what's happening in the eternal realm and how you are actively sweeping the earth, searching the earth, looking for your lost valuables. Thank you for this message tonight. Thank you for this great ministry of the New Beginnings Church. Continue to use us to join you in the work of the ministry. Thank you for teaching us your heart so that we can know your heart, trust your heart, believe your heart, and proclaim your heart. That's our prayer tonight. Smile on every family and every home present and represented in this Bible study. We love you and we need you. Now is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen. Family, I want to thank you so much for being a part of this great ministry. Thank you so much for being a part of the work that's taking place in the harvest, the feeding, the clothing, the ministering, the celebrate recoveries, the Bible studies, the jail ministry, prison ministry, the youth ministry, children's ministry, proclamation work through the Angelos Biblical Institute. Thank you so much, beloved, for keeping the faith, holding fast to the vision, and faithfully proclaiming God's word in every area in the life of this church. I'm so grateful to be your pastor and grateful to have you to co-labor with us in the earth. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. Listen, have a glorious week. Keep shining the light in the dark areas of this old world that fallen men and women, boys and girls may see our Father in heaven and glorify his name and come running asking, what must I do to be saved? Have a great week. Peace.